about you, and maybe your friend too. I'ma show up so we can do our thing. You know that I need you, and every time I see you, I'ma show up so we can do with my thing. I'm circling around spots, got the stack for the green in the brown box, looking at the girl in the dress with the brown dots. One, two, three, and it sounds hot. Go and tell me how it sound, nah. Yeah, I think we got a banger for him. Call the glasses so we can go and hang it on. Yeah, California, yeah. Got a room full of models in the spot I make. Go and roll on them, tell them they can come my way. I'm on something high in the summer. We can rock, pull the fresh in the Hummer or the drop. I'm doing my thing.
Dilla, Dope Dilla Podcast. It's going down. It's your boy Jamal Doman.
Toby Hicks, Dope Dealers.
Episode 19?
19.
Oh, yeah, man. We moving and grooving,
was,
man.
That was a hot track, man. That was a little different than the last 2 weeks. We had the sexual tracks. That was some bumping.
Yeah, I like that. That was actually, that's a return. That's Brent the Bachelor. That was Brent the Bachelor featuring Nocturnal. That's his new single called We Can Do Our Own Thing. We Can Do Our Thing. He's a bachelor's from Los Angeles, California. So shout out to him. He sent us a song a while ago, and we played it before.
Cool,
so
yeah.
He support. He shot us out on his page and everything, and you know, he show us love. So shout out to Brent the Bachelor doing your thing. You know how we doing the Dope Dilla Podcast. If you send us original music, we will open and close the show out with it. That's how we do it. So please, man, you know, send us that music, man. Yeah. What's happening with you, man?
Oh, man, just hanging in there, man.
We got a special show today, man.
Oh, man, this is, we've been looking forward to this one.
Yeah, we got the good brother.
Before we started the podcast,
I know.
Spoke about this.
Yeah, we got the good brother in the house, man. My big brother, man. Listen, this whole hour is just gonna be to him, so we ain't even got to get into nothing else. Let's go right into it, ladies and gentlemen. This is a self-made media mogul. Man, it's like I know you so well, but it's like I still got to. How do I introduce this brother? This guy's real important and special to me. I mean, my career, I wouldn't be where I'm at if it wasn't for this brother. This is one of the first people out of Philly to believe in me, man. This, we call him in Philly, he's the big brother of Philly. That's what we call him. Ladies and gentlemen, he discovered Boyz II Men, discovered Meek Mills, Miss Jade, Yaz the Greatest, Hakeem from Empire, executive producer of movies, got a new movie he executive produced called Canal Street that's about to hit stores, hit the arena now. Came up in the game with Fresh Prince and Jazzy Jeff. Let's bring him right here. Ladies and gentlemen, the big brother of Philly, Mr. Charlie Mack is in the house.
I get the bell?
The bell.
Yeah,
you get the bell.
So how many bells do you get if you, like, totally certified?
Hey, man, you get all the bells, man.
Yeah.
You get,
So everybody else just get one ring.
Really? Yes.
You got multiple rings.
So
yes.
First and foremost, I want to give supreme shout out and congratulations to both you, Toby. You know what I'm saying? My brother Jamal right here. Jamal, not only my brother, that's my Muslim brother.
Yes. Assalamu alaikum. Yes.
And again, yes, absolutely. Sound like him. We just came out of Ramadan. Had a great Ramadan.
Yes.
And blessed Ramadan.
Shout out to all the Muslim brothers and sisters around
absolutely.
The world.
But I definitely want to give Jamal an extreme shout out because, again, I watched him literally from Philly coming out here and staying in it.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Staying in it. And going from tickling.
Yeah. He used to watch me bomb. Let's keep it 100.
Bombs over Baghdad.
Charlie Mack used to watch come down to the improv and get in the back of the room.
Get him all.
I'll be up there bombing, and all I hear is him in the back of the room. Get him all. Get him. Don't worry about him all. You funny.
Get him all.
Don't worry about him.
That's right. And listen, let me say something to you. I got to be honest, man. I ain't going to lie to you. I've never seen nobody, I'm talking about evolve in the way that Jamal's evolved. And Maul will tell you, I don't play no games. You earn it every ha for me.
Some comedians he don't mess with. We're going to get into all that.
We're getting to all that. But I'm saying to you that Jamal is certified a comedian. Certified comedian.
Yes,
you know
sir.
I mean? Ain't no. Like he. Listen. He earned every laugh that he's getting. He earned every standing ovation, every clap. No one gave him anything. He earned it.
I appreciate
every
that.
Every young girl, young guy out there that's trying to be a comedic timing. Listen to me. Look at Jamal Doman's story. Check him out. I'm saying that he's been doing this thing. And I salute you, brother.
I knew I made it when I made him laugh, Toby.
Hey, listen, please.
You make him laugh.
I understand.
It's only certain, we argue about it. It's some comics he don't really matter, and I think they funny, but we'll get into all that. But
listen.
One thing, you need the Charlie Mack stamp of approval.
Listen to me.
The making it, yeah. So mm-hmm. when you did your weekend and mm-hmm. y'all was in Atlantic City.
Mm-hmm.
And you remember y'all had BBD, yeah. MC Light there. Yeah. And I remember you let comics go up because yeah, the Alex Thomas was in the house. Mm-hmm. And you was like, hey, I'm putting you up. You're gonna go do your thing, man. Absolutely. And you gave me the that's when I knew, oh, the brother Absolutely. Believe in me. Absolutely. He's like, yeah, Absolutely. I'm giving you 10 minutes.
The thing about I always wanted, again, in life, you don't want no gimmies.
No, right.
You wanna earn that. You know what I mean? You wanna be able to sit in a room yesterday, I'm saying, and be in there amongst your peers and like I earned the spot to be here. Nobody looked out for me.
Mm-hmm.
I did this.
No, right.
Totally. And I support you. I support you and salute you.
So listen, this hour is about you, good brother. We're going to talk about, let's take it to the beginning. But you know what? It's a question a lot of people ask me who know you, who know I know you. Mm-hmm. They, you know, always people like, what do he do? Or people, yeah. just, who is Charlie Mack?
You know, the running joke on Martin was, what did Tommy
do? Yeah, what did Tommy do? What's his, because our people like, what's your homie do? What did he actually do?
He's here, he's there. Yeah.
He's everywhere. He's at the BET Awards and he know everybody.
What is it that he does?
Who is Charlie Mack? If somebody was to ask, who is Charlie Mack?
First and foremost, I'm the son of Allah.
Yeah.
That's the first thing. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And my birth parents, you know what I'm saying, are Evangeline right. and Charles Ramey.
Yes.
Born in South Philly.
Mm-hmm.
Moved to Southwest Philly, moved back to South Philly, moved back to South Philly, moved back to Southwest, moved to North Philly, moved to Alney, moved back to South Philly, moved to Alney. Moved to Germantown, and then moved to Southwest.
You was all over Philly.
Literally a black gypsy. Like, yeah. you know how back in the day when your parents were renting an apartment for a year?
Right.
Do a year lease.
Mm-hmm.
But we wouldn't re-up.
Mm-hmm.
The day before you had to re-up, we could move on. So my father and mother were always looking for a better, so if the rent was $250, looking for something for $235. You know
wow.
what I mean?
You
know, they're looking
wow.
for a better, you know, they're looking for a better number, get a better mm-hmm. number. And so, it really haunted me for a long time, even my adult years, because I was so used to moving.
Well, yeah, right, you know right, I mean? Right.
And the entertainment business actually supported that.
Yeah, because you always moving. Yeah, you traveling. Yeah.
So from that, my initial entry into anything entertainment was 1976.
Wow, was that? Yeah, I didn't know it was that.
11 years old.
Okay.
Right, and Kenny Gamble did an event called Clean Up the Ghetto.
Okay.
Right, and so he took all his artists, Patti LaBelle, McFadden and Whitehead, Teddy Pendergrass, Billy Paul, and he took them to throughout South Philly and cleaned up the inner city.
Mm-hmm.
He cleaned up the neighborhood, and as weird because I didn't connect with none of the artists I connected with Kenny Gamble.
Right, right, right.
So it was weird. I'm saying 11 years old.
Gamble and Huff. We was just talking about them in the barbershop. Yeah, it's funny. We was talking about them in the barbershop today. They said every 13 seconds, one of their songs are played on the radio in the world, somewhere in the world.
Oh, yeah. That publishing is well over 300. My brother over here, Vance DuBose, he worked with Kenny and them for about a good 4 years, from 99 to 2002.
Yeah. That's funny. Mm. We was just talking about that in the barbershop.
Yeah. So he was... Aside from my uncle, he was probably the most impactful person in my life at that moment.
Wow.
Like, really, I'm telling you. And so I just seen what he did, and I was like, I want to do that. I didn't even know what that was
right.
that I wanted to do,
right?
But I want to do that
right.
at 11 years old.
Yeah.
And then a couple years later, roughly around probably 2-3 years later, then this thing, hip-hop comes.
Hip-hop comes, yeah.
You know what I mean? And I'm like, it just kind of touched my spirit
yeah.
and my soul.
Hmm.
And I just was very much so. I was always the very outgoing, social, kind of interacting, brother. You know what I mean? I've always been that way. I've never been afraid to, like, approach people.
Right.
Then I started hanging out from, like, 76 to about 82, 83. I started being down the Spectrum and down the Spectrum and Veterans Stadium, like, almost, like, it seemed like it was every day.
Right.
But it was enough for me to formulate a relationship and cultivate a relationship with Harold Carmichael, Will Montgomery, Ray Ellis, Daryl Dawkins, Clint Richardson, and Franklin Edwards.
Wow.
So they essentially were my godfathers.
Right.
So I would go from the Sixers facility at the Spectrum and then walk over to the Veterans Stadium.
Wow.
And carry, Ray Ellis, Will Montgomery's bags. Actually, how I learned how to drive was on Will Montgomery's 280ZX.
Wow.
He asked me, do I know how to drive? And I said, yeah, I know how to drive. So, of course, I never drove. And then it was a stick shift. So he took me to the bank. He literally parked in the driveway. And I'm sitting there for about a good 2 seconds, sweating like a hog. I'm talking about, the next thing you know, I'm like, I got it down. I started driving. So from that, they used to tell me, they said, if we ever find out you're doing wrong, you can never come down here again.
Mm.
So my mother and father had broke up around. My mother and father broke up probably around, I want to say,
The reason we paused because the legend, Rick Ross, just came up in here, man.
We're not going to disrespect the legend. The legend is, yes sir.
I just watched his Netflix documentary.
Yes, sir.
I just watched it, man, and your whole story.
Let's put a pause on me.
Oh, yeah.
The brothers probably.
Let's say, yeah, ladies and gentlemen, Dope Dilla Podcast. Rick Ross just walked in. The real Rick Ross. Let's get that.
Mr. Freeway Ricky Ross.
Freeway
actually
Ricky Ross.
A friend of mine told me today, the reason why, no, that's for you. The reason why is because you live next to the freeway.
Yeah, that's why they call me Freeway Rick.
Okay.
1-2.
There we go. So that's what they say. They said the reason why he called him, I never knew how they got the freeway, because see, I come from the streets as well, and I hustle. I thought because you hitting that highway real hard.
No.
It was because of the freeway.
We didn't have no problem hitting the highway, though.
Yes, sir.
No problem with hitting the highway.
So, Jamal, go ahead. I mean, y'all.
I want to finish with, I know you're here to do, but we want to get you on a future podcast, so I'm going to get you info.
Because
we do this every Tuesday, man. We definitely want to get you on here.
All right, let's do it.
Shout out the legend.
Freeway.
Yes, Mr. Freeway Ricky Ross. The legend.
On the Dope Dealer Podcast.
Yeah, I know. Ain't that crazy?
Yeah, this is a true blessing.
And you're doing some good things in the community. I watch your Netflix special, man, and then we're going to talk about it.
Tell them to go get the book.
Yeah, that's right, the book.
Go get the book.
What's the name of the book?
Freeway Rick Ross Untold Autobiography. You can get it on my website, freewayrickross.com.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. And we'll talk about the book when you come back, man. We'll definitely bring the book in.
Right on.
Yes, sir.
Ooh, man. That is it.
Wow.
Yeah, man. That's crazy.
That's what happens
man.
Here at the Dope.
Yeah, exactly, man. Charlie Mack, bring him in, man.
Listen, my brother, good brother, Vance DuBose. You know
yes,
what I mean?
Sir. Yeah.
You know.
So you're messing with the Eagles and some Sixers. So this is early mid 80s. Okay.
This is actually hanging down at the Spectrum Veterans Stadium. This is like right like 80, 81. And I remember Ray Ellis and Will Montgomery and I'm telling me, if we ever find out you're doing wrong, you can't come back down here no more.
Right.
Mm-hmm. My mother and father had broke up in about 78. And so times got hard.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And I just needed to make an end to the nonsense.
Right.
So I started working at a hoagie shop named Eddie's and Joe's, Eddie Simon and Josephine Simon. And so they were husband and wife. They were essentially the hood heart to heart.
Oh, okay.
Right?
Heart to heart.
So Eddie's and Joe's. So Eddie Simon's grocery store was on one corner. And then Miss Josephine, her store was on cheesesteak spot, was on the other corner.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so it was my first entry into, unbeknownst to me, to write numbers. Because they used to, Mr. Eddie would say, write this number down. Now take it over to my wife.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was like 11 years old, I was writing numbers.
Wow.
So I just remember them giving me tips.
Yeah.
I remember seeing my first head job, you understand what I'm saying, 11 years old, in that store.
Yeah.
A lot happened in that store.
Damn.
So it really was my first entry into anything that was underground.
Right.
You know what I mean? And I love both of them. I'm saying they gave me the opportunity to make money.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I was making it legally because I was working in a grocery store.
Yeah, you were,
I was a stock boy.
Right.
I was like the assistant stock boy.
Right, if you will.
Mm-hmm. And so from there, I got bit by the bug of hustling.
Mm-hmm.
I found it, you know, to be something that would bring me relief, and I loved it. You know, I absolutely loved it. Again, didn't realize the damage I was doing.
Right.
I just loved the fact that I'm saying that I didn't have to be poor.
Right. Right.
You know, I mean, my father. Mm-hmm. I don't know what him and my mother's issues were.
Right.
I don't really know to what degree that was. I just know that I needed to end that madness.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so, from me hustling, I had three jobs at 11.
Wow.
I had a paper route.
Mm-hmm.
I worked at Eddie Simon's, and I used to sell jewelry on 11th Market.
Damn,
like 11th Market.
Yeah, 11 years old, and so from there, then I wanted to do a house party. So I did a house party with my man Captain Flash, and my first house party was was 250 kids.
Wow.
Right? And I remember writing it out, Charlie Mack Productions.
Charlie Mack Productions.
It was a dollar party, and I was selling 3 chicken wings and a soda for $2.
Oh, hi.
Yeah, I was selling.
You can't beat that. Yeah.
Right. So my mother was like, why you got all these kids in here? I was like, Mom, you told me that you wasn't going to do anything for me. You told me I had to get, I had to make a way for myself. And I'm like, okay, I'm trying to make it happen. And so my first party, that's what bit me with the bug.
Right.
From there, years later, I hook up with, I'm hustling. At this point, I'm hustling.
Right.
I'm making money. Then I hook up with Mimi Brown.
Yeah.
And Mimi Brown essentially was the Philadelphia version of not, as big as she was, didn't look like or wasn't doing the gossip stuff, but she was big, much like Wendy Williams.
Yeah, yeah, I remember. Okay. Yeah. Shout out to Mimi Brown.
Mimi
yeah.
Brown.
She's still around, yeah.
Mimi's still around. And so I started then with Mimi. And then at 83, 84, 85, I started doing shows.
Yeah.
My first show was, I did Dougie Fresh, Roxanne Shanté, and Parliament Funkadelic.
Where you doing
it?
At the Man.
Wow. Oh, the Man thing. Oh, wow. Yeah, the Man Music Theater. Okay. Man.
And Dougie was my first legit relationship, entertainment relationship,
yeah.
Brother.
Yeah. Dougie y'all still partner. To this day.
Did they bring the mothership Parliament?
All that was there.
Oh,
all
that was shit.
There. All that was there. And
did you make money off it? Did,
absolutely.
Did, okay.
You know, right. Well, that hold 15, 20,000 people.
Yeah, yeah.
So well, about 15.
How old are you?
At this point, I'm around 18.
Wow.
Damn.
So are the promoters, are they looking at you crazy or are they?
No, because the thing about it was is that it's weird because the things that I was doing, I think about it today, and I look at my kids. I'm like, I couldn't imagine my 18-year-old daughter doing the things that I've done.
Yeah.
I couldn't imagine it.
Yeah.
It just didn't even seem like nothing like out of the way because it just was like second nature. I was hustling. I was making money. I was providing. I used to take care of my whole basketball league.
Mm.
I would buy the whole league, the basketball uniforms, pay the whole league fee.
Right.
And it didn't even seem like anything that was out of the norm for me. Mm-hmm. It just became second nature to me. I became a person that looked out for people.
Right.
Like this was a natural thing.
Right.
You know what I mean? Even with my later on, we'll talk about that with my weekend, and I had started doing that stuff like 78, 80.
Yeah.
I was, 79, 80. I started doing this pretty much the like the neighborhood gathering.
Right.
And I would take the local artists there and we would just do a block party. I would shut down like 2 miles of traffic.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Yeah. People were coming up there, Southwest Philadelphia, to support it. And some people ask me today, like, you know, how'd you do this? I said, I've been doing this since 1979, 80. I've always had a way of galvanizing human beings.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I've always had, that's been my gift, to be able to bring people together.
Wow.
So from dealing with Mimi, I did the first Charlie Mack annual Husker convention in 1987 at this place called the Southwest Castle. And
you said Hustler Convention?
Hustler Convention.
Okay, all right.
Right? So it was a party. I just gave it a name.
Okay, all right, cool.
But who performed there was, I did two of them. Who performed at the first one was Stetsasonic. Stetsasonic, MC Breeze, Robbie B, and Jazzy J.
Okay.
And it was a couple, Devastating Four. I had a group called Devastating Four.
Okay, all right.
Then I did another one where I used Biz Markie.
Okay.
And this was May 7th of 87, I think it was.
So, he had Pick 'n Boogers. And Nobody Beats the Biz was out by
the Vapor. That was before the Vapor.
This was a historical night right here because he brought a young man with him. And before he ended his witchcraft, he said, I got a friend of mine from Brooklyn. If y'all don't mind, just let him come up and introduce him.
Mm-hmm.
He comes up on the stage. And he does his freestyle. He throws the toe Kotex out. And he says, R-A-W, a terrorist.
Here to bring trouble to
phony MC. So Kane first did that record 6 months before it came out on my stage at my
hospital. Wow.
First time he did it was in Philadelphia at my show.
Mm-hmm.
And then from there, I think that night, Jeff came to my party.
Right.
Me and Jeff went to school together.
Okay.
Jeff came to my party. And he was like, I got arrested July 7th and July 30th of the year prior.
Mm-hmm.
And I had opened to a case.
Oh, wow.
So 3 felonies in a federal case.
Yeah.
Right? So Jeff came to the party with a friend of ours named Wood, brought him to my party. He came up to me and said, Charlie, he's like, would you mind working with us? We got a record called Girls Running in Trouble.
Mm-hmm.
Would you mind working with us? Mm-hmm. I was like, I'm thinking, like, work with you. And then I thought about it. I was like, he was like, you do security, don't you? But I thought about it. What I would do, I would double that security.
Yeah.
I would do my show.
At your shows, yeah.
I would double the security. So he thought that I was doing security. So I needed a way out.
Yeah.
He said, ain't the money you used to making, but, you know, you can go out with us. And so my first trip was going to London to do, he's the DJ, I'm the rapper.
Wow.
That was my first trip with him. And so it was weird because at that same moment, MC Breeze. I was leaving MC Breeze. MC Breeze was my first note. Actually, G5 was my first group I actually worked for.
Yeah, yeah.
And they had the record called 454.
Mm-hmm.
And so from working with them, there was EC LaRock, there was Bruce Johnson, there was Daryl Jones,
mm-hmm.
and I'm trying to think who else was with it, but they was on what records were they on? Lavario Records or something like that.
Okay,
anyway, yeah. But anyway, when we won the Super Bowl, when we won the championship, they did a celebration record.
Oh, the Sixers.
Sixers, okay, thing, yeah. Right? So from that, then I started working with MC Breeze.
Mm-hmm.
I met him up at Al's place up 52nd and
Discombobulated Boobalade.
Yeah, so he was the one that actually first one to put me in on the record.
Yeah.
Charlie Mack was the first on the limo.
Okay.
The first the limo because Charlie Mack.
Oh, hey, okay.
And so from there, it was weird because he was on the show with Biz. We had a little tiff. We decided we were going to part ways. Mm-hmm. It was at the same time that Jeff came. Jeff came, mm-hmm. and Jeff came and
Dope Dealer Podcast.
Dope Dealer Podcast. And listen, you know how it's on fire.
Yeah, it's on fire. That hot. So
Charlie Mack bring the heat.
So from that, Jeff asked me would I work with him. I still had the two open cases. I had to get those off of me.
Mm-hmm.
I happened to that July, August, I beat those two cases. And so that November, I went overseas with them to London.
Okay.
And that's what we did. We stayed there for a month, and we did an album that y'all know as He's the DJ, I'm the
He's
Rapper.
He's the DJ, I'm the Rapper. Yeah, that's the second album, right? Rock the House was the first album. Yeah, yeah. And then those that don't, young folks listening, that's Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince. That's who we're talking about.
So that spawned, of course, Parents Don't Understand.
Yeah.
Girls Are in Trouble.
Yeah. Brand New Funk.
Charlie Mack, First Out the Limo.
First Out the Limo.
Brand New Funk, yeah. As We Go.
That was the shit.
Like, again, so it was a classic album. Yeah. Live in Union Square.
Yeah.
Classic album. It went on to sell like three
plus million records. Yeah, that put them on the map.
One was, the first winners of the Grammys Award, mm-hmm. at UMTV Award. You know, so mm-hmm. it was the first in that, in that category to win.
Yeah.
Also, we boycotted the Grammys.
That's right. Yeah, I remember
that first year.
Yeah.
So from that, I was a young kid that I grew up with in South Philadelphia. His name was Nate Morris.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Nate Morris, when I was going with Mimi, I came back home off a tour one time. Mimi said, Charlie, can you go with me? I have a gig today. And it was up 16th of Susquehanna called Susquehanna Day.
Right. So, I remember,
So I go up to Susquehanna Day, and these five guys run up to me. And Nate says, tell him, Charlie Mack, tell him you know me. I was like, yeah, of course I know you, Nate. He said, this is my group, Boys and Men.
Mm.
He said, can you listen to us sing? I said, well, when y'all going on? Because I'm getting ready to leave. He said, well, we're going on next. They get on stage, they sing Can You Stand the Rain?
Mm.
And it put chills up and down my whole body.
Wow.
Damn. So I'm like, God. But I remember Nate being in a rap group called JDTR.
Yeah.
He was in a rap group. So I was like, I remember him rap, but I did remember his family going to church every Sunday.
Yeah.
I remember that.
So you didn't know him as a singer, you knew him as a rapper.
No, I knew him as a singer. Yeah. I knew he was in a rap group.
Right.
Mm. When he was growing up, I remember they load up the station wagon,
mm-hmm.
him and his family, His sisters, two sisters, his brother's mother, and his father. They were loaded the station wagon up to go to church, and they had a choir. They would sing.
Yeah.
So I remember that, what I mean? And then so it came back to me like, you didn't used to sing. So he was like, yes, my group, man, what can you do for us? Could you introduce us to this, to this? I said, well, I'm going to do you better. I said, I live with Fresh Prince up in Lower Marion. I said, mm-hmm. I'm going to bring you up to the house. They was excited, jumping up and down. So I go home, and I tell Will, I said, I met this group. Boys the Men, they're incredible. They sing better than No Edition. He was like, all right, we'll just bring them up. So they come into the house, they sing for him. But at that time, Will's 19 years old.
Yeah, yeah.
He's just totally, totally in his world.
Yeah.
So he's not thinking about anything else mm-hmm. other than what's on his table, right? I understand it.
Yeah, yeah.
Rightfully mm-hmm. so. So we are invited, Will, myself, to Mike Tyson's birthday party at the Palladium.
Oh, wow.
Go to the Palladium, and BBD is there.
Mm-hmm.
I go up to Mike, I say, I got this group named Boys and Men in Philly to sing y'all songs better than y'all sing.
Yeah.
Like, man, get out of here. Whatever. Yeah. I said, I'm serious. They'll sing y'all songs better than y'all sing.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, all right, we'll be in Philly next week at Powerhouse. Come to the show.
Yeah.
Bring them to the show. So the day comes, the PD comes up to me, Dave Allen says, Charlie Mack, you got this group named Boys and Men looking for you? I said, yeah. I said, where they at? Because they were getting impatient. BBD had finished their set.
Yeah.
I said, where the group at? So two of them had snuck in, the other three I got in, finally wrangled them all in. We got to backstage. They did the same thing for me. Backstage for probably about 100 people.
Yeah.
Saying, can you stand in the rain? And of course, it was like, blew you away.
Yeah.
So Mike pulls me to the side, like, yo, what you trying to do? We could do it together. But I was like, I'm trying to get Will to do it over the job.
Yeah.
But so when we went back, you know how they do all the station birthday parties and all the artists come in, off a tour, come from different cities.
Yeah.
So we went back out on tour the next day. Mike stayed in Philly, brought his car in. He took them up to New York.
Yeah.
Got them up unbeknownst to me. I didn't know.
You ain't know.
Right? So he takes them up to New York, introduced them to Gerald Busby. And as you they met the guys backstage, hey, boys the men.
Yeah.
So as you know it, you know, rest is history. 6 million records later.
Yeah.
That happens.
They more than 6 million. Wow.
No, 60 million. My fault.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
60 million records later. Boys II Men become the biggest R&B group in history.
Yeah, they
R&B music, yeah.
And they still working. I think they in Vegas now. Yeah. They, wow. Yeah,
man, that's crazy.
So that happens. I go on to work with, I think I started working with, after that, I still was working with Jeff and Will, but I started working with, I want to say Melody Teller.
Yeah, I remember. Yeah, shout out to the champ.
Worked with Melody Teller.
Mm-hmm.
Worked with him for a couple of years. Then I started road managing Javon Pearson.
That's right. Shout out to Javon. Yeah.
I was road managing him.
What's up, JP?
JV. What up, JV? What up, JV?
Now, around this time, you also started your weekend around this time, right?
I started my basketball game in 1990.
Okay.
July 7th of 1990.
Yeah.
So then my first Charlie Mack celebrity basketball game. Actually, the irony about it is where Boys II Men were discovered is where I used to do my games at.
Yeah, yeah.
At the Civic Center.
At the Civic Center, yeah.
So we did that. It's so much. So we did that. And then I remember meeting with the Civic Center, and I told them I was going to bring in New Kids on the Block, Mike Tyson.
Mm-hmm.
Jeff. They was like, yeah, whatever.
You was tripping.
Right. So they seen all them people pulling up in the driveway. They were blown, especially when they seen New Kids.
Yeah.
They seen New Kids. This is some other stuff.
Yeah.
So Donnie and, it was Donnie and I want to say Lance.
Mm-hmm.
Donnie and Lance. I think it was, Donnie and Lance. But three of them came out.
Yeah.
Three of them came out and they were blown away. Then you seen Big Daddy Kane and Kwame.
Yeah.
Jeff and Will. I mean, it was a star-studded.
Yeah.
It was star-studded, you know what I mean? Wow. And so for that never, ever, like, happened in the history of Philadelphia.
Them basketball games your weekend. I was a kid, girl. Yeah.
We set the town off.
Yeah.
We set the town off, like, totally.
Yeah, yeah. Tommy Hearns. I remember one week, I didn't even really know. I'm a kid. It was your weekend. We're in North Philly somewhere at some kind of gym or something. It was something going on there, and I just remember... I just heard a bunch of screaming. I'm talking about everybody. Ah! And I'm thinking it's a fight. I'm looking.
Yeah.
And it's Charlie Mack and rest in peace from Martin.
Tommy from Martin.
Tommy. And I'm talking about 1,000 North Philly kids just ran up to Tommy from Martin and went crazy. Yeah. I mean,
wow, that's
cool. I remember that, man.
Yeah. We had everybody that was prominent in the culture was in Philadelphia.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, that was one of the great things. I'm saying I always had a keen sense on creating relationships and nurturing them, cultivating them. And I always say your success is based on your relationships.
Yeah.
I always say that. You know what I mean? Oh, but what Q Deezy, Q Harris is checking us out.
Q Harris, what's up, man? Q Deezy.
Fox, yeah, he said, get you something. He said,
Q Deezy, what's up, homie? He's doing his thing. We got to get him on there, too.
Absolutely.
Q, I'll be home, too, man, and I want to do that show.
Yeah, absolutely, come on. But, so we do that. Jump into Meldrick Taylor, Javon. From there, I move out here.
Yeah, because around Fresh Prince Town?
No, I get Task Force.
Task Force.
And we signed them to A&M Record Company, which was also Steve Albert. I want to say it was the last name. It was the label that Jan Jackson was signed to. A&M Records. Jan Jackson's label and Sounds of Blackness.
Okay.
They were over there.
Yeah.
And so we were there for about a good 3-4 years.
Yeah.
Put out a couple of records.
Yeah.
It got a little lukewarm. It didn't go as I planned.
Yeah.
Then I kind of backed up from it. And then I started promoting shows real heavy.
Yeah.
I stayed home and started promoting shows. That's when Will actually got. Oh, wow. I jumped past that too.
Yeah. That's why. I was like, the whole Fresh Prince era.
So at this time.
How did that come about?
That's what I'm about to say. At this time, this is like 80. That's like, I got jumped back to 80, 88, 89. Me and Will are hanging out in L.A. a lot. We're hanging out in L.A. a lot. We got invited to the Rhythm Nation album release party.
Right.
Jimmy invited us to the album release party. And we come out here, and from me being kind of like just at all with L.A., I'm like, Will, we got to think about something outside of hip-hop.
Yeah.
And I don't know how they even came over me, Anyway, the destination places when you would come to L.A. was you go get a rental car from Quapna, then you go to Roscoe's, and then right from Roscoe's, you go over to Cross Street to Arsenio Hall Show.
Yeah.
So that was like mandatory.
Yeah.
That was what you did when you came to L.A. So this particular day, we get to Quapna's, and he said, Michael Jackson's going to be at Arsenio. I'm like, well, we got to go there.
Yeah.
He's like, all right, well, that's what we do, Posse Deep, you know what I mean? So we get in the car, we go there, sit in the audience, I look over to the corner. And back in the day, you used to read the album CD jackets.
Yeah.
Right? For the credits and see. And I looked over to the left and I see Benny Medina standing over the corner.
Yeah.
I was like, Will. Yeah. I was like, Will, that's Benny Medina right there. He's like, who? I said, that's Benny Medina, the vice president of Warner Brother Records. I said, I'll be back. I walk over to him. I said, how you doing? I said, my name is Charlie Mack. I said, I'm with the Fresh Prince. He said, that's the kid that we talking about. His mother went away on Whiskey Vacation. He stole the car. I said, yeah. And I don't even know, again, why it came over me. I said, we're looking to do some guest spots on television shows.
Yeah.
He said, he wants to do TV. I said, yes. He said, I got an idea for him. He met Quincy. 6 weeks later, was the pilot for The Fresh Prince.
Wow. Because that, a lot of people don't know, that was Benny Medina's story, right?
Benny,
yeah.
Benny went from Watts to Beverly Hills.
Yeah, that was the story of Benny Medina, yeah.
So that's how that happened. So then jumped to, around, again, mid-90s, I started doing a bunch of shows at the Studio West. I was doing everybody from, and I would have everybody up there. So from Mike Tyson to Martin Lawrence, I would do Maine Source, I'd do Chubb Rock.
Yeah.
I was doing all the national artists up in 60 of a market.
Yeah.
So I would do that. Then it got a little crazy and people started getting, you know, losing their lives. So I kind of like, okay, I got to end this situation.
That's Philly.
I joined the Nation in 89, joined the Nation of Islam. Very, very much so in that. So it was like same time was me and the Nation, I was working with Meldrick. So I was with Meldrick when he lost to
Julio Cesar Chavez.
The second time. The second time I was with him. We did it. We fought Clint Brown at the Civic Center. And I did the whole Coming to America theme. I had the rose petals and everything. You know what I mean? So we did that. So we did that, jumped to Task Force. From Task Force, doing shows. Then in 97, I moved to L.A.
That's right, yeah.
I moved to Los Angeles in 97.
Then what major? Was it time?
I did that hit that I took in Lang City.
You know what I mean? That's fine.
That Don DC Curry, that Teddy Carpenter show.
Oh, wow.
Torrential downpours that I had. And it's crazy how God worked because that night I'm sitting in there sulking and JL called me up, Will's manager, Tom, said, yo, I need you to go overseas with Will tomorrow. Packed my bags up, came out to LA. And I stayed out here from 97. To 2003.
Yeah.
Wow.
I think 2000, I want to say 2000, my man, Terrence Glasgow, he called me up. He said he had this girl.
Yeah.
A rapper. And I was like, let me hear her. And so it was, her name was Jade at the time.
Yeah.
But there was a group named Jade.
Yeah.
So I was like, we got to change that name. We got to put Miss on the front of it.
Yeah.
And she rapped for me. And I was like, God.
This was around the time I got a ring. Yeah.
God.
I
remember. Damn.
Yeah, I remember.
Right, so I called
Omar. Shout out to Miss Jade.
I called Omar, my partner, you know, my brother, my little brother called. I said, oh, we got this girl from Philly. We got to do something with her. So he calls Timberland up, and we take her to Tim. She burns Tim head off, burn Missy head off. So they want to sign her. But my thing is she was so, Jade just loved Jay-Z.
Right.
So Jay came to Philly at the Spectrum. I take her down to meet Jay-Z, and she burns his head off. And this at the time when he was doing
State Property?
No. He before that he had the, he, remember he had
it was oh that was him
Amil,
yeah
Amil,
yeah
and Ja Rule.
I forgot the I know what
it was
you're talking
firm,
about
it
wasn't a firm
Jay what was the name of that crew but anyway she gonna tell me what the name of that crew was but anyway so he was sitting in a little side room I put Jay walk in there and she give it to him light him up he's like listen I'll get rid of Amil for Jay. But what I looked at was how Jay-Z was working with Beans now.
Yeah.
And I said, well, he'll never let them be bigger than him.
Yeah.
He's an artist.
Yeah.
He's competitive. You know what I mean? He was an artist. So I thought that Timberland and Missy, because they were producers first, they would be better served.
They'd be better,
For Jay. You know what I mean? And of course, we went on, we did the deal with B Club 215.
Yeah, my man. I remember.
Myself, Man, and
Omar. Girl Interrupted, first album, which classic.
Amazing.
Classic, yeah.
She had records with Jay-Z.
Yeah, that album was slept on, man.
So we did that. We did that, I think, about 2002, 2003. I moved back to Philadelphia.
Yeah.
My brother gets murdered. My second brother gets murdered.
Oh, wow.
Dez, rest in peace. And shout out to my niece, Shania, she's checking us out too. So we do that, come back to Philadelphia, and I'm like, I feel like compelled to do something.
Yeah.
Because I had stopped doing my game in 97. So I felt compelled to do something. I met a group of mothers called Mothers in Charge.
Mm-hmm.
I went and met with them. Of course, I'm a brother, so I couldn't be a Mothers in Charge. I was a brother in Lennon's hand.
Right.
So I said, I think I want to kind of find a way of galvanizing the community.
Mm-hmm.
So I made phone calls to Gabrielle Union, Tisha, Tashina, mm-hmm. Will, Dwayne Martin, literally like 50 to 100 different celebrities.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I said, I want y'all to come to Philadelphia, and I want to just kind of try to hug the community
yeah.
in a way that had never been done before.
Mm-hmm.
Marsh Chestnut, because mm-hmm. that movie, Boys in the Hood, Men's Society, where he was murdered.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I said, well, the difference between that and real life is when John Singleton calls cut, or the Hughes brother called cut, Marsh going to get up and go about his business.
Yeah, he go about his business.
I said, in real life, that doesn't happen.
Yeah.
You know mm-hmm. what I mean? I said, when they call cut, the life is cut.
Right.
You know what I mean? And so I just needed to find a way that, you know, a lot of times what happens is our children will listen to celebrities,
mm-hmm.
right? And I said, okay, these are my friends. I said, so what can I do? I'm saying, as a brother, what can I do? I said, I think I got an idea.
Mm-hmm.
So I created the Charlie Mack Party for Peace Celebrity Weekend.
Right.
And we did a march. We went up to the juvenile, youth center.
Yeah, the youth mm-hmm. center, yeah.
House correction.
I came up there one time with y'all,
And mm-hmm. we would go and just try to galvanize the community, have dialogue with the community, and try to uplift and just try to give them some light in that dark tunnel.
And that was always a great thing about your weekend. I remember we went up there to the youth study center just to see them, see the kids and see how excited they was. I remember Clifton Powell gave a great speech. Alan Payne, we've had speakers speak. Mm-hmm. Alan Payne gave a great.
Tamla Jones. Chico.
Yeah, and
Monique, Queen Latifah.
I think somebody was telling me the story. Was it Chico, or somebody, a kid who couldn't come out.
Chico.
Like, he was fighting, so they wouldn't let him come out.
Yeah, he was basically okay.
So they kept him in. He couldn't come in. He pissed. Yeah. So Chico went up there
and
said, let me go talk to him since y'all ain't going
to
let him out. So he went up there, and he was like, what's going on mm-hmm. with you, man? He said, man, I've been fighting, so they ain't going to let me come out and see the celebrities, man. Mm-hmm. I'm mad. He mm-hmm. said, well, what you fighting? I like to fight, man. And Chico said, well, you know they pay people to fight. Mm-hmm. Like, pay mm-hmm. people to fight. Mm-hmm. He's like, hey, you know, you should try to, when you get out, like, you know, you know, you can get paid. If you like to fight, you can get paid
to
fight.
Yeah.
Get in the ring, learn. And I heard they kept in touch. And when he got out, he, you know, made him, you know, hooked him up with a, took him to the ring or something like that. It took him to, got some training. Yeah. So,
wow, that's cool.
And we built the playground. We did some great things, man.
Along with Keystone Mercy.
Yeah, sir. Yeah. Keystone the Charlie Mack Cares. Is that, yeah.
Charlie Mack Cares. That's what we actually into now. We're going to do that. Yeah. But so from that, from during the weekend, a couple years later, I get a group called 5 p.m.
Yes, yeah, I remember that.
Get the group
that.
5 p.m. and I redo a record, Can't Let You Go, with Biggie sample in it.
Yeah.
And I need a rapper on it. I want a Young Chris on it. So a friend of mine, Brock, said, yo, you got to check out this guy. It's a guy, a young boy named Meek Mill. He got a record card in my bag.
Yeah.
And so I was like, all right, let me meet him. So I drive up to Ridge Avenue, 25th and Ridge, and he gets in my car and he plays this record, I'm not a rapper.
Yeah.
And I'm like,
I'm not a rapper, I'm a trapper. I remember the yeah.
He played that for me, and I was like, God damn.
Yeah.
Now, this must have been 2008, 2009,
mm-hmm.
2006, I produced a movie called ATL.
Mm. I forgot all about it.
With T.I., of course, Lauren London.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Chris Robinson directed. Chris Robinson
directed. I did it, you know, along with, I was standing in for Overbrook, for J.R. and Will. They asked me to go down there and just oversee, you know, mm-hmm. on the behalf of Overbrook. And me and T.I. became very, very close friends, much like brother, little brother, big brother.
Yeah.
Still today. So we did that. And then, like I said, I called T.I. up. He was out here. He had been arrested, and he was prepping himself to go to jail.
Mm-hmm.
But he did a paper trail. Recording paper trail.
I remember that.
I said, Tep, I got this kid here. I fell off and they, I'm telling you, he's mad. Yeah. He said, well, bring him out. This was on a Friday. Came out to L.A. Tip was running like three studios.
Yeah, I went down there. Yeah, I was there. Yeah.
She was there. So he was running like three studios. So Meek literally was watching him in this process of recording. Yeah. From that, he rapped for him. He talked to him. He said, man, I want to offer you a deal.
Yeah.
So at that point, we came back to Philadelphia. While I was going back to Philadelphia, Meek tells me he got a case.
Yeah.
A case. So I'm like, damn. We got deals on the
table. Yeah, we got,
Because we were offered a deal by Warner Brothers Records as well.
Yeah.
In addition to, Kevin Black offered them a deal.
Yeah.
In addition.
Yeah, I remember. I think I went up there with y'all when y'all met with him. Yeah.
Of course you were.
Yeah.
You're always with me. You know what I mean? So we go up there and he has two record deals. So we get back to Philadelphia. You know, we go through that process. Meek goes in and does Flamer. He had this coin phrase named Flamers. Mm. I said, yo, we should just start brand new Flamers. So he did this mixtape called Flamers, and he got locked up. And while the process of that, just before he got locked up, he had did another mixtape called Flamers 2.
Flamers 2.
Phenomenal.
That took the city by storm.
Phenomenal.
Flamers 2?
Phenomenal.
Ooh.
Wow. Phenomenal.
Yeah.
And he was like Jay-Z on a local level.
Yeah.
Because every kid knew every ad-lib. Yeah. They knew everywhere. I've never seen nobody, I'm talking about without national success, to have the type of appeal.
Took over the city,
On a local level like that, meaning on the Philadelphia side.
Yeah.
Wow.
Tri-state area,
So he just really commanded the attention of, the people, 8 to 80. I mean, older people loved him, young people loved him.
Mm-hmm.
So we did that. From there, we went our separate ways. I stayed out the business for about 3 years. I just kind of was just doing shows and doing some things. And then a young lady I knew for about 20 years, Andrea, had asked me to, it was a young lady named Sanji, and Andrea had asked me to see check their kids out. So one young lady, Sanji's daughter was Adrian Sparks. Andrea's son was Hakeem. It was Hakeem. Was Brashear.
Brashear.
Mm-hmm. She said, I want you to check out my son. So I wasn't making myself available, and then I got invited by Sanji to come to the TLA to see Asia. When I'm sitting up in the audience, this kid rides out on his bicycle. And I'm like, they said, yeah, it's the greatest. I'm like, I think that's the kid.
Yeah.
So I watched him. I was like, damn. I was like, he got something. It's like he was dancing. He had props. He was reminding me much of a Chris Brown.
Almost. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like, wow. I said, I could see it.
Yeah.
And I really almost like it was like the C's party.
Yeah.
So I was like, damn. I was like, I could do something with this kid.
Yeah.
So I go back and I was supposed to be there to see Asia, but I loved Asia.
Yeah.
But I was I was crazed about Yaz. So I tried to, man, his mom was talking for about a good probably 4 to 6 months about, trying to work together. We trying to work it out. Finally, we came to resolve, and we were able to work it out. I took him to Troy.
Yeah.
And I let Troy hear him. Troy was like, Charlie, I need to hear him. If you say he the guy.
Yeah.
He gave me a budget for him. We went on to start working on his mixtape.
Yeah.
Right in the midst of that, Lee Daniels' sister, Leah Daniels, called me up and said, Charlie, you have a kid that can rap and sing? And I thought about it because Yaz, we had distant movie Brotherly Love.
Yeah.
And he auditioned for it.
He auditioned.
And he stumped
it. It didn't go great. Yeah.
He was like, I never want to work.
So he, yeah.
I never want to do no TV or film no more. I just want to work on my music.
Mm-hmm.
So the kid that I was thinking about, this guy named DJ, this group I had called Distinguished Gentlemen, I was thinking about using him, but then I said, I don't manage them no more.
Yeah.
I said, I manage Yaz. So I called Yaz. I said, Yaz, I got a friend of mine working on a TV show, a pilot. I said, I want you to come on audition. So he comes over to my house up in Winfield. I take my iPhone. The scene that that Lucius and Hakeem are talking about on a pilot episode, he says to him, you acting spoiled. You need to work on some new music.
Mm-hmm.
That's the audition.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
That's the audition. So they send it out to Leah. About 3 or 4 hours later, Leah hits me up and say, Charlie, this kid right here is talented. He's raw, but he's talented.
Mm-hmm.
Lee loves him. Mm-hmm. This was like a Wednesday night. She said, can we get him out here tomorrow? So we try to get him the plane ticket. He misses his flight.
Mm.
Friday night, Leah calls me up and say, Charlie, the studio want to see him now. We got to get him out here. So Monday comes, my man Jamal Hill, he's going out to L.A. And so essentially what he did is chaperoned him.
Yeah.
He prepped him in the airport, came out to L.A. And it worked out great because on Friday, he'd have just been in there with Lee.
Yeah.
Monday, it worked out great how God works things out.
Mm-hmm.
He goes, I'm talking about cold from the hood. He goes off the plane, goes over to Paramount, walk into the room, Taraji, Terrence, Lee, and the studio head.
Wow.
And he don't break. Mm. He doesn't break. He runs the lines, and he's a little bit off because he's just raw.
Yeah.
But Terrence pulls him over and says, listen, this your role.
Mm.
Just settle down a little bit, and I'm going to run the lines with you. He started running them, then Taraji started running the lines with him. So you got to think, you got Baby Boy, and you got Hustle and Flow.
Woo.
You know what I mean? And you just coming, you don't got 25 cents in your pocket.
Yeah.
So
two Oscar-nominated actors.
But he nailed it, and he nailed it such that from that meeting, they said, you have the deal from the meeting.
He didn't have to audition again.
6 weeks later, the pilot for Empire.
Woo!
And so, again, then we do, we're going to do New Edition.
New Edition movie, yeah.
And we're doing New Edition.
I assisted Honey. Him for you.
Yeah, we do Honey.
Honey.
We
Sprinter.
Sprinter.
Canal Street.
Canal Street. Yeah, we have a lot of great projects going on. We have a lot of great projects that I've produced, yeah, along with my partner, Jamal Hill.
Shout out to Jamal Hill.
Jamal Hill.
Yeah, we skipped over Streets and...
Streets, we did Streets. Yeah, yeah, there's a lot. So I'm doing a book called Charlie Mack, My True Life in Town from the Hood to Hollywood. It's so much.
Yeah.
So much that for me to kind of just like totally compress it into 1 minute, you know what I mean? So it's really like I kind of just gave you a capsule. Of
yeah, yeah, you get. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
But again, we could jump into some questions and how this and that. You know,
no, nah, man, listen. You know. No, it's all about, yeah, I just, this I want to know the story. History, yeah, this is it. Because you kind of skipped over.
I skipped over a lot.
Yeah, you skipped over.
Because I want to sell the book.
Yeah, you went to, you write about, listen.
I want to sell the book. If I give it all away today.
No, you're right.
So I'm trying to master.
Because you skipped over meeting Fresh Prince, boy. You skipped
I did.
Over.
I skipped over a lot.
Yeah, okay.
But the thing about it is, it's all in the book.
Yeah, leave it. It's all in the book. Yeah, we had the porn boy here a couple weeks ago. Yeah. He said the same. He had a book. He's like, oh, read the book.
Read the book, right. So if you're interested, and that actually sounds good to you, then you absolutely should purchase the book when it comes out. Next year will be 40 years I've been in entertainment business.
Wow.
So I started in 78. I didn't even realize what I was doing. That was Street Team. Yeah. So my uncle, talk about Matt Covington, Philly Devotion.
Oh, yeah. Matt,
That's how I got into the business, the music business. Because Matt was part of Philly Devotions. Mm-hmm. Then he left Philly Devotions and he started singing. And so he started a record label called April Records. And I would go around hanging up posters, going to the club, giving out the big 12-inch, you know, the singles. I would go to the club and give out the singles. Mm-hmm. I would go to radio station, pay them, play the record. Mm-hmm. So I was Street Team, you know what I mean? Not even knowing.
Street Team.
At 14 years old. So I got bit by that bug. Then I was going Mimi. And so it just kind of just lined up. And I just walked in my purpose, you know what I mean? And here I am today, 2018. Next year would be, 40 years.
Damn. Wow, that get the bell right there.
Yeah, yes.
And all the changes. Yeah, I mean, you rode the wave of all.
That's the amazing thing, right? Yeah. I'm 52 years old, and I've still been able to be, I don't need to be the hot dude.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? And I'm still relevant today to a 12-year-old, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Which is really a blessing.
Yeah.
And I don't take it for granted. You know what I mean? I understand it's a responsibility. I treat it as such. Such that, 2018? So 2014, I purchased a building. Somebody gave me a flyer of the event I did on May 7th, 1987. Yeah. They gave me a flyer. Mm-hmm. I went and purchased that building.
Wow.
The Southwest Castle.
Yeah, okay.
To create the Charlie Mack Care Center.
Yeah.
Physical fitness, education, and arts for kids 13 to 19. So that's the building I purchased. So that's what I'm looking to do. That's really what it's about for me.
Yeah.
So when people ask, the running joke on Martin is, what does Tommy do? It really came full circle when my daughter came home, because you know when you're in school, your kids are in school, they say, what do your mother do? So my daughter comes home one day and say, Daddy, what do you do? I'm cracking up laughing. I'm like screaming. She's like, why are you laughing? Because I was dumbfounded.
Yeah.
I didn't really know what I did.
Right. But
because I have this very intimate relationship with God, as I always do, I never ever do anything without praying to God.
Right.
So I go to bed at night and I ask him, and just simple, you look on my IG, it says it, the servant. So I am the big brother, the servant, Charlie Mack.
Mm.
That's who I am. So everything else, so to try to say manager, a consultant, producer, none of that. It's like I'm here to serve God's children.
Right.
So whether it be getting a record deal, whether it's actually going to a youth study center, whether it's giving somebody, words of encouragement, it's all serving God's children. We all just servants.
Yes.
That's who we are. And that's really what it's about. So trying to put a label on me really is criminal.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm a servant.
Right.
And that's what I'll do. That's the thing that I really want to be. When they say, when it's all done and said, what do you want me to know for?
Yeah.
That man came and he served.
Right.
That's
right.
What I want.
Wow.
That's what's up, man. That's what's up. It's good having you on a Dope Dealer podcast. I mean, two comics, because you love stand-up comedy. That's one I... And you,
love it.
I respect your opinion.
I'm funny, too. I'm funny too.
Yes, sir.
Am I not funny?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'm funny. Hey, listen, I'm funny.
So let's talk about the comedy game, man.
There's a lot of stuff.
I wanted to get your opinion. I know you kind of was like the referee in the Kevin Hart, Michael Blackson thing.
Javon keeps hitting me saying, tell him who's my top comedians in Philly. Javon, you're number 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, okay?
Hey, Javon.
Okay, Javon.
Javon, I'm on that top. No, give me your
top 5?
Well, should we do? Well, because a lot of us ain't even in Philly no more.
Yeah.
So you do you?
Let him do.
Well, let's say the top five
from Philly.
Yes, top five from Philly.
Top five from Philly.
And you keep it 100. I mean,
top five from Philly.
Yeah.
Start from five.
I would say Javon would be top. Javon would be
Javon
in my top five.
Funny. Javon, absolutely. He's definitely
top five. Impact he made. Javon would be top five.
Other than I'm gonna tell you like this, because you understand, Javon was the first comedian that meaning myself, Jazzy Jeff Fresh Prince, we embraced.
No, no, right? He did.
Javon
was that dude.
Javon actually, I'm saying again, a lot of, so other than probably, what's his name? Chubby Checker Brother.
Dick Tracy.
Dick Tracy. And what's the kid that had
Dick Tracy is like the J. Anthony Brown of Philly.
Yeah, what's the kid that had the show on NBC?
Oh, Ralph Harris.
Ralph Harris.
Yeah.
So other than them two, Javon was the most notable.
No, yeah, you're right. Yeah,
I've seen Javon.
I think Javon was even more notable than Dick Tracy, but not more than Ralph.
No, he was. He was more notable. I say other than them.
Yeah.
He was the most notable one in Philadelphia.
Yeah.
And so definitely. Mostly every comedian, I would say, they probably would lie if they said that they didn't look at Javon.
No, that would be a lie. I looked up to Javon when I came out. He was that dude. Yeah.
He was that guy. You seen him on TV.
Yeah.
You seen him with Jazzy Jeff Fresh Prince. Yeah. You seen him, you know what I mean? He was that.
I'm going to tell you a funny story. Javon, you still listening? Brian Dennis booked me and Javon in Maryland somewhere, and I'm new at the time. I maybe got a hot 10
minutes. I remember Brian Dennis, yeah.
So Javon obviously is the man. So he's the headline. I go down, we drive down there. I go up, I do all right. I do okay.
Okay.
Javon go up there and kill it. Do his thing. So after the show, we in the back just chilling. Brian Dennis comes in and say, hey, I'm back there with my head down. I'm like, man, I feel bad, Javon. Like, you're all right.
That's when you still were tickling people.
Yeah, I was still tickling. That was new. I was 1 year in the game.
Yeah.
So Brian Dennis come back. Brian Dennis like, hey, man, the show was cool. Hey, it's two girls out there want to meet y'all. I'm like, oh, okay. I kind of peep. And one was bad. I don't know if Javon remember the story.
He listened to you.
One was bad. One was all right.
Okay.
So I'm like, all right, cool. So Javon doing something. I'm gonna get myself together. I go out there. I was like, hey, nice to meet y'all. I heard y'all want to meet the comedians. I remember this like yesterday. The girl looked at me. She was like, not you, the other comedian.
Oh, shit.
I was like, let me go get him.
Yeah, you tell me that story.
I was like, let me go get him.
Funny.
That's a true story.
Yes, Javon, you're absolutely top five.
Yeah, I'm going to tell you my top five.
This is the thing. I'm not going to put it like in a space until I'm going to say right now, today, if I did kind of like, if you will,
Mount Rushmore.
Mount Rushmore of Philadelphia comics.
Oh, yeah.
Like, absolutely. You
Javon would have to. I'll say, listen.
Who's next?
I'll say Javon, Teray, Blackson, Kevin, and Ronnie Long, and Jamal Dolman, I asked. But Ronnie Long was, like, Javon was the man. Javon was the most popular, but to me, Ronnie Long was, whoo, he was that nigga.
He was funny.
I used to sit and study Ronnie Long. Shout out to Ronnie Long.
Yeah, I ain't gonna put it in no particular order.
Yeah, I'll
just say Javon is in the top five.
Oh yeah, Javon.
That's what I'm gonna say.
Shout out Javon Pearson.
Because there's a lot of funny guys out of Philadelphia. There's a lot of, and I just don't believe that there's a lot of funny people.
Who's the other four then?
I ain't gonna put it in no order because again, it's like it could be different people in different times, like every 5 years or every.
No, I don't mean order. I mean just who your favorites, like.
Oh, you mean
five? Five.
Oh, you mean period.
Yeah, five from Philly, not in
from
order.
Philly. No, I can't. Not from order. I can't say it from Philly.
Do you keep up to the new generation, like the new young cats? Okay, yeah. you know some of them.
Yeah, yeah.
Who you like who, Ken Jones? I like Anthony Moore.
I like Skeet.
Skeet, yeah, I forgot all. Skeet like is
Skeet.
A hustler.
I like Skeet. That's what I like. I like Skeet.
Shout out to Buck. You got to put Buck in there. Buck is the
hustler.
Yeah, yeah. You got to put Buck.
Hustler. Buck hustles comedy.
Oh, yeah, Buck.
If he don't do comedy, he hustles comedy. You know what I mean? It's a difference. You know what I mean?
That's fine.
That's what he do. You know what I mean? So, Buck, I love Buck. That's my brother as well. You know what I mean? But I'm not going to do no. Again, Buck will tell you, Javon was the person that actually, you know, gave him, put that light in the tunnel for him. You know what I mean? So, again, you know what I mean? I owe Javon a world of gratitude at a very dark time in my life. I'm saying he gave me an opportunity to be his road manager.
Yeah.
And he insists that he gave me half of the money.
Yeah.
He would not give me like 5%.
Yeah.
He was like, no, take half. You know what I mean? And so I love him. You know, that's my brother.
Shout out.
That's
wonderful.
That's my brother. No, shout out. Real G.
Shout out Javon Pearson, man. Yeah. Def Comedy Jam legend. He killed it. Showtime at the Apollo. So we're talking about Blackson and Card. I know you kind of refereed that. I guess that's over with now.
Yeah. That's just a responsible thing to do.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Kev, you had to be the big brother in that
Kev called me up, and then I was talking to Mike, and just, again, I'm saying, you just have a conversation. Because guess what? If a real OG, that's what you're supposed to do.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And so for me, I don't take credit for that. I appreciate the love.
Yeah.
I appreciate the respect that they would actually lean on me and trust in me. I'm saying that I could actually be a mediator in that way to whatever degree.
Right.
So again, thanks Kev and thank Mike for allowing me to do that.
Yeah, that's you brought a lot of cats to the first time to the set. I remember you brought Lil Rel to your weekend. A lot of people ain't know who Lil Rel was.
And I remember that's my genius in knowing.
Yeah, comedy, and you, but I kind of knew him. I remember he telling people like he had him on his comedy show. Yeah. And I mean, a lot of people was like, "Well, we know him. We know him, but who is that?" Right. And Charlie was like, "Just wait."
Yeah, hey, I remember.
I told him. No, I told him. Yeah. I told him. I
said just wait, and he went up.
Yep.
Nigga, when I tell you after the show, everybody was like, oh, we know who he is. I'm talking about he destroyed.
I heard a crazy story about one of your weekends. I heard one weekend, Jaleel White, he dumped a trash can on somebody.
What's that? I think he did do something like that.
G-Thing, was that?
Yeah, I was told it was G-Thing.
Everybody dumped on G-Thing.
He dumped a trash can on G-Thing because G-Thing was hosting. He kept calling him Urkel.
Yes.
And Jaleel said, hey, bro,
I think that was Alex. Alex kept calling him.
That's Alex Thomas?
It might have been G-Thing, because G-Thing was Ace Hosted. I think it was. It might have been.
G-Thing
was doing more of the court side.
Alex wouldn't have done.
So probably was G-Thing. Probably called him.
Yeah.
I remember one time G-Thing was trying to clown Gilly. He didn't know who Gilly was. I told him, hey, man, they ain't the one right there. Like, he was trying to clown Gilly. I was like, nope, you don't want to leave that alone.
Right.
You know that nigga blocked me. You know that bitch ass nigga. He done blocked me.
I don't want to get into all that.
Yeah, we get that, all that. So we're gonna keep it on comedy game. Monique, I know that
she love Monique.
Yeah, we love
Monique. Monique actually, again, Javon, how I met her was through Javon. Mm. We used to go down Baltimore and she would do a club. Here's Javon right here. He wants the legend.
Man, can we make him bring him. Hey, Javon, hold tight.
Get somewhere where it's real light lit at so you can see you.
Javon,
Stop moving around. Get somewhere where it's lit.
Javon, hold on. We gonna get you on the microphone so we can hear
you. Hold on.
Oh, yeah, he's going to try to set something up. JP, Javon Pearson, a legend. Hey, Javon, we're going to talk about the fight we had.
Javon, stop moving around. Stop moving around. Stand still. Move over a little bit in the light. Move over to your right.
Sorry, Paul.
Right there. Right there.
Let's see if we can cheat.
Stay right there. Stay right there.
Yeah, he cool right there.
Hey, hold on, Javon. We gonna try to get you on the microphone.
Vance DuBose. Come here, Vance.
The legend.
What's up there, everybody, Vance?
The legend.
Hey, listen. Freak. That's right. There you go.
What's happening?
He said the Schuylkill Expressway.
The
Schuylkill Expressway.
What is that?
That's an affiliate. It's basically the river runs throughout Philadelphia.
Oh, yeah.
Hold on. Javon, can we hear you? Javon, can you hear me? Javon.
Can you hear?
Javon Pearson.
I can't hear you.
He said he can't hear.
Okay, all right. We may have to call you. I'm going to try to call you on the phone. Is his number still the same?
Yeah, his number's the same. Yeah.
All right, I'm going to try to call him on the phone. Give me that. So, yeah, that's the we're going to talk about. I'm trying to get him to talk about the time we got into a fist fight.
Can you hear now?
Is this number still the same? It's the Dope Dealer Podcast. We're live right here, man. So much going on, man.
A lot of moving parts.
Yeah, so much going on.
Yeah. Yeah, talk real quick. Let me grab this picture real quick.
Okay.
Yeah, talk real quick. I'm coming right back.
I'm going to try to bring Javon up on the.
Right back.
On the speaker.
Yeah, keep talking. Come right back.
Let me see if we can. I only got 3% on here.
It's a lot going on.
Yeah, it's a lot going on.
With crazy.
It's
like dope being sold today.
10 minutes.
The person you have called is unavailable right now.
That ain't Javon number. Ah, man. All right, so we'll try to see if I can get him at somewhere else. So yeah, it's so much going on, man.
Man, I'm just sitting there like.
Yeah, I know. We got
I'm
Rick
just
Ross.
Watching. Yeah, this is,
Let me see if I can get. Maybe I can get him from Charlie phone. So go ahead. What you got going on this weekend? You got anything going on?
Oh, yeah. I'm going to Orlando this weekend, June 28th through July 1st, Thursday through Monday. 6 shows with my man Felipe Esparza, the Bad Decisions Tour at the Orlando Improv. That's June 28th through July 1st. July 3rd, pre-4th of July show at home in Silver Lake. 8 p.m. right here in L.A. Everybody want to make it out, you know, come out the night before the 4th of July. And the 4th of July, I'll be headlining the Wind River Casino in Redding, California. I know you like on the 4th of July, yes, because up there they said that they're going to do their fireworks on the 3rd, and they coming to the comedy show on the 4th. So I'll be there on the 4th.
So that, yeah, so that's all right. So cool, man. Cool. So you working, man. Shout out to Felipe, man. Shout out to the armed forces, man. You know, we do this, and we do this for you guys, man. Army, Navy, Marines, Air Force.
It's Independence Day.
Shout out to all the armed forces, man. And listen, we got something going on. Listen, if you want it, we need you guys to subscribe to us, rate us, and leave a review. And listen, if you leave a review on iTunes, we're going to give you a free t-shirt. I got a bunch of t-shirts made by Plus, Weed Dispensary Company. So this is what you do.
Dope dealer.
Yeah. You leave a review on iTunes, and then send me the screenshot on our Instagram page. Instagram page is called Dope Dilla Podcast. That's our Instagram page. And if you send me the screenshot, then DM me your address, I will send you a t-shirt. Just send me the size or whatever, and I will send you a t-shirt, man. So that's how we do it, man, on here, Dope Dilla Podcast. If you please rate us or leave a review. I was trying to call Javon, but he wouldn't.
So what you did, right?
What?
You didn't share it.
Oh,
the video,
shit.
So it went all blank. Recorded.
Yes. Damn, my bad. Hey,
here's right.
Oh, there you go. Okay. So if you leave a review, subscribe to us, man. That's, you know, we need you guys, man. Shout out to our sponsors, Dome and Cheap Movers, the number one moving company in San Fernando Valley. You familiar with Dome and Cheap Movers, right, Joe?
I am. That's the best moving company in California.
Yes. Yeah. You need to move?
We can make it for smooth. Cheap. Yeah, for cheap. Yeah, not so cheap, but, you know.
Right. Not so cheap.
Because people do be calling.
Affordable
movie. Affordable
movie.
Affordable, you know, professional
movie. We want to know cheap movers. So what's your budget first?
Yeah.
What are you willing to invest in the moving
that's
services?
That's funny.
The relocating
that's
services.
That's what I should rename it. What's your budget? What's your budget?
Movers. Absolutely.
What you got?
Absolutely.
Before I forget this, LeBron James and Paul George, hey, we need your services in L.A.
No, you do not.
Fuck all this bullshit. This is the showtime. We need them in L.A.
We need them in Philly.
By the time this shit, you know, gets ready to air, you guys will be about ready to make that decision. LeBron, Paul, George, we need you.
I disagree on that. We need y'all in Philly. That's what we need y'all in.
Well, I personally don't agree.
What you?
And Kawhi Leonard, fuck the Spurs. You right.
I feel like I love LeBron. I just think that the young boys playing with young money, playing with house money.
Mm.
They're playing very free, and it'll be very mechanical. I think he'll take from them. You know what I mean? Mm. I think he'll throw their whole rhythm.
You talking about LeBron?
LeBron would, because LeBron essentially is coach first.
Yeah.
GM first, coach, then player. You know what I mean?
And there's a lot of people in L.A. that feel the same way.
About him coming here.
Yeah, it's a lot of people.
But I think him and Ben will be able, but I think Paul George is a better fit because we do need a two guard.
What I would love to have is like a Paul George and like Kemba Walker.
Mm.
That's what I would.
Are you done with Ball, huh?
No.
Are you going to keep it?
He's talking about Sixers.
I'm talking about Sixers.
Yeah, we don't worry about Lakers, Ball, man.
I got done with the Lakers when they shipped my man out, my brother out, Shaq. I was done with them at that
point.
I was a Laker fan when I was living out here, but only when they played the Sixers, I was a Sixers fan.
Yeah.
That's how I was rock. But I'm saying I don't mess with the Lakers like that. Sixers all day long.
Let's see if you can call Javon Pierce. Okay. I don't know if you can get him. Hey, did you get the video I sent you at the after the Evander Holyfield Mike Tyson fight?
I've been
3 minutes. Okay. I'm watching the Evander Holyfield Mike Tyson old school fight, and after it's over, they showing Evander Holyfield walking to the dressing room. Guess who's right behind him?
They've been doing that a lot.
Yeah. Guess who's standing right behind him?
They've been doing that a lot.
That's funny.
I don't know if we
yeah, they've been showing him old fight. Yeah. I seen that joint.
Yeah. And Tyson was your homie.
He's gonna pick up.
Let me see if we hear.
He's gonna definitely pick up. That's the speaker, so. Yeah, Mike Tyson, my brother. For sure.
Javon, you hear me? I don't think
I
we
hear
did.
You.
Yeah, no, so we hear. No, we hear.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Javon, what's up?
What's up, Mar?
Javon Pearson, a Philadelphia legend. Welcome to the Dope Dilla Podcast, man. I've been trying to call you. Whatever number I had wasn't the same number, but
You need to get a better phone.
Ask Javon, who's top five is?
Yeah, Javon, who the top five out of Philly? Who you? You in my top five?
Excluding yourself.
Excluding me.
Because you know you in my top five. You heard me say that, right?
Excluding me.
Yes.
My top five.
Yes.
Jamal Dorman.
Okay.
Ronnie Long.
There you go. Teray.
Where I'm at? I'm at 3.
You're at 3.
Kevin Hart.
Mm-hmm.
And Dick Tracy.
Dick Tracy. Ooh. So you ain't putting Blacks in there or Buck?
Mike in my top 10.
Okay. Okay. I like that, man.
Put him in my top 10.
I like that, man.
But he's hilarious. He's doing his thing, you know.
Yeah.
If it wasn't for no Javon, there would be no other comedian.
There you go. Listen. I totally agree with that. Javon, you put Philadelphia comedy on the map.
I brought it to a different front, like, because none of the comedians after me ever did Apollo. And
right.
That will show you. If you never did Apollo, that will show you if you're funny or not.
Yeah.
As soon as you walk on stage.
You won Apollo how many weeks? You won it like a few weeks, right?
I won it 1 week, but okay. I was on there as an amateur once.
Yeah.
And as a guest 4 times.
Okay. Okay. Mm. Def Jam twice, good right?
Sure. So, you know.
Def Jam twice, right? You did Def Jam twice, right?
I did Def Jam twice.
Yeah.
Yeah, with Martin.
You ever do Comic View? Did you do Comic View?
I was the head writer of Comic View. Come on.
Oh, that's right.
I do Comic View.
Come on, man. My bad.
How do you think Gary Owens got funny?
There we go. There we go. Talk that shit, Javon.
No punches.
Talk that shit, Javon.
Gary's a good guy. You know, he just needed that push, because when he became the winner of Comic View, they hired a bunch of comedians to write for him, and all the comedians was giving him bad jokes.
Mm.
And I was giving him good jokes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so they fired everybody, and it was 2 guys, and they made me the head writer.
Damn.
Made the other guy the extra writer. So, mm-hmm. You know.
So, they was giving him bad jokes on purpose, huh? Damn.
On purpose.
Wow.
On purpose. He'll tell you. They gave him bad jokes. They wanted him to fail.
What was two of the jokes, your top 3 jokes you gave him?
My top 3 jokes?
That you gave him.
That I gave him?
Yeah, that you gave him. Yeah, some jokes you gave him.
I don't even remember. I don't even remember. Yesterday.
Hey, Javon, you remember that story? I don't know if you heard that story I told about when me and you did like somewhere in Baltimore.
Yeah, when we was in Maryland.
Yeah, I bombed them 2 chicks.
Yeah, man. You ain't bombed. I was thinking you was going to work in the kitchen after that. I was like, well.
Damn. In the kitchen.
You were the worst comedian. You was worse than my boy, God rest his soul, Gumby. Remember Gumby?
No, I was, hold up. Don't, listen, I would smack the shit out of you through this phone. Gumby had 3 jokes.
But no, Gumby was funny.
Yeah,
Gumby had 3 jokes.
Damn.
That night.
Hey, Javon, I'm going to tell you and Charlie a quick story about Gumby. Brian Dennis, the one and only, booked us on a college show, one of them college shows he was robbing motherfuckers. So we get there. Brian is there. Brian say, all right, this the lineup. He said, somebody went first, somebody else. And he was like, Gumby, you second, and Jamal, you're going to close it out. At that time, I was a little bit more. I had like 20 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
So Gumby starts having a fit. Like, well, why is he going? I'm a veteran. I got credits. Mm-hmm. I've been going. Mm-hmm. You know, he starts, you know, and Brian, like, what are you talking? It's like, why he got, I got credits. This is disrespectful to me.
Y'all getting the same money, though, too?
Yeah, I think so. I'm a veteran.
Brian doesn't give nobody.
Yeah, well, yeah, what? Cool I'm a veteran. He starts going off. So, Brian, I'm like, Gumby, you can go at last. I don't give a fuck. I'm getting the same money. I don't give a fuck.
Yeah.
So, Brian, like, no, I said this is the lineup.
Yeah.
This is the lineup.
Okay.
This is how I go. And I'm like, Gumby, you only got 3 jokes. Like, what are you talking about? Oh, nigga, I got more. So he goes up before me. I'm thinking he going to prove to me, because now he got the nigga went up there, did the same fucking 3 jokes. And he got off stage. I'm looking at him like, nigga.
I'm kind of apprehensive about being a parent.
What was all that?
I'm kind of apprehensive about being a parent.
What was all that for?
Is he still in the game?
No, he passed away. God rest his soul.
What was his line when he first walked on stage? What did he say, Charlie?
I'm kind of apprehensive about being a parent.
No, he walked
in
the audience,
he's
like, what the fuck is that?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man, the good old days. Javon, we got to get you on another episode. We could talk so much, man. Dick Tracy, Kenny Ray Walker, Ronnie Long,
Vince Patterson,
man, the good old days, man.
And Bishop's brother.
Remember Pernell Tucker?
Charles Walden.
Yeah. Charles Walden is on there.
He in my top.
Yeah, he should be in the top. Yeah.
Keith Robinson.
Remember Pernell Tucker? Oh, used to tell everybody he was Chris Tucker.
Cousin. Pernell and Gumby was on
Charles
the
Charles is cool. Yeah,
same,
Charles funny, level. Man.
D. Lee. We can talk about D. Lee.
D. Lee wasn't. He ain't in my top 10. He might be in my top 200.
Okay. All right. Listen, we got to wrap it up, Javon. I appreciate you, man. Listen, we going to get you on the episode, man. Call you back, man. I'll be in Philly this weekend, man. I'm going to chop it up with you.
All right, well, hopefully I ain't in the hospital, but I'll see you guys.
All right, man. All right, brother. I'll holler at you.
All right, take care now, bro.
That's Javon Pierce. All right, so listen, we got to wrap it up, man. Charlie, we could have did 2 hours with you, man. We got to bring you back, man.
When the book come out.
Yeah, definitely. When the book come out. What's the name of the book one more time?
Charlie Mack, My True Life in Town, From the Hood to Hollywood.
That's right. All right. And Canal Street coming out soon.
September
14th, yeah. Man. We appreciate you guys, man. Please
Season
rate
5
us.
Empire.
Yes, season 5 Empire.
We start back filming July 18th.
Please rate us, review us, listen.
Tell a friend, man.
And God bless y'all, man. Dope Dilla Podcast. I'm Jamal Dolman.
Toby Hicks.
At Jamal Dolman, at Toby Hicks. If you
TobeHixx.
If you want to book us for a show, we at Dope Dilla Podcast Instagram page. It's called the Dope Dilla Podcast. So hit us up on that. And God bless you guys, man. Episode 19, we
at
out.
Charlie Mack first out.
Yes. I'ma show up so we can do our thing. You know that I need you. And every time I see you, I'ma show up so we can do our thing. Put your knuckles up, I show up, I'm a bottom with a bubble butt. I'm number one, you the runner up. I hit the game with a nigga, then I triple up. I am the West Coast, I don't give a fuck. You say the wrong thing, use a dead duck. I am the planet, use a peanut. A deer in headlights, man, you just stuck. Baby Rick Ross with a new truck. I always make the team, man.